Hello, Bond fans, and welcome to my latest 007 movie review, where today I review the 12th film in the 007 film series, which is Roger Moore's fifth adventure as 007. For Your Eyes Only. Directed by John Glen and released in 1981. The basic plot of For Your Eyes Only is as follows. James Bond is assigned to find a missing British vessel equipped with a weapons encryption device and prevent it from falling into enemy hands. There you go, that's the plot of For Your Eyes Only. For Your Eyes Only, well, released 2 years after Moonraker, and of course Moonraker being very controversially received, the producers thought, well, we might as well bring Bond back down to Earth, literally. So For Your Eyes Only ends up being a more back-to-basics route, I guess you could say. So far, I've enjoyed all four of the movies in the Roger Moore era. Of course, Roger Moore did 7 movies, and I'm not going to have the same reaction to all of them. And I'm afraid For Your Eyes Only is one of my least favourites of Roger Moore. There was a time even when I considered it my actual least favourite of Roger Moore's era. In terms of that, I don't know where I stand on the next two films, so we'll have to wait and see when I review the next two films how all of Roger Moore's era is for me. For Your Eyes Only for me has always been a bit of a it's just kind of meh, very run-of-the-mill, you know, doesn't really stand out to me. This film is kind of dull, the plot is not very engaging at all. In a similar sense, it's kind of reminiscent of From Russia with Love, because it, you know, the whole going after the device thing, that was very reminiscent and that's been done before. The weird thing is though, For Your Eyes Only is, it tries to be a bit more serious, and yet it still has these really weird, campy, humorous things in at the same time, so I feel like For Your Eyes Only is tonally confused. I mean, first of all, let's start where it starts. The opening scene of the movie, which, okay, I appreciate the callback to Tracy from Honor Majesty's Secret Service and the fact that they said, oh, we have all the time in the world on the grave. That was lovely, and that was a nice moment for the film to open with, and it was kind of bittersweet, really. Then the opening scene, which I have to say, this is probably one of my least favourite openings of the entire series. I know, for legal reasons, we can't say he's Blofeld, but let's be honest, it's Blofeld. Blofeld in this film, like, what the fuck were they thinking? Honestly, I don't know what to say about this, because this is just baffling. I know this is meant to be kind of like Bond's revenge for Honor Majesty's Secret Service, but it's so separate to the rest of the story that they really should have just changed the opening scene. The opening scene should have been Melina's parents being killed. That would have been a great pre-opening title sequence, and somehow Bond could have been involved in that. This thing, this helicopter chase with Blofeld is stupid. The dialogue is really stupid as well when he says, I'll buy you a delicatessen in stainless steel. What the hell? So I don't like the opening scene, and I don't think the helicopter chase itself has any tension or anything fun about it. It's just, it's not really exciting to watch. It really isn't. And the way that Blofeld is dispatched of is almost really silly. The hook of the helicopter grabs the wheelchair, and then it throws him down the kind of the big tube, the big funnel. I don't know what it's called, but you know what I mean. It's just stupid, to be honest. And then, on the flip side, the end of the movie. The end of the movie has this really awful scene with Margaret Thatcher, at the time who was the Prime Minister of England. And the scene is stupid because Max the Parrot has the little watch which Bond could communicate to the Minister with, and then, like, the Prime Minister doesn't realise that the Parrot is talking to her. It's so stupid. It's really awful. It's so ridiculous. I would have cut that out entirely. Like, how could they not realise that it was a parrot talking to them? It's just so dumb. Especially when the parrot says, give us a kiss, give us a kiss. And then she goes, oh really, Mr. Bond? When her husband is right next to her. It makes no sense. The end of the film should have just been Bond and Melina having their romantic moment, and then they go for a swimming. No, she does when she takes their clothes off, and then she says, for your eyes only, darling. Another dumb thing about this movie, BB. I hate BB. I cannot stand BB in this film. Okay, she's not in the film for very long, so I'm not going to get angry about it. What I will say is I am dumbfounded as to why this character is even in the film. She literally adds nothing to the story. She's there as a like a secondary Bond girl. She's preparing for her ice skating championship or whatever the hell. You don't really care, to be honest. And we find out she is actually Christatos' niece. He completely mistreats her. But the worst scene in this movie, aside from the Margaret Thatcher ending and the Blofeld beginning, is BB waiting in bed for Bond. Excuse me for a moment. Oh, for God's sake. I honestly don't know why they wrote this in. Roger Moore is a great James Bond, don't get me wrong. But he's starting to get into his 50s now. And this girl, Lynn-Holly Johnson, I believe was in her 20s. If that, she looks very young. And the fact that they even kiss is cringy. People complain that Bond and Mayday is cringy in A View to a Kill. Well, I think this is worse. The fact that Bond actually turns her down is a good thing. Don't get me wrong, that's a great thing. But the fact still, it's just awkward. It is so awkward. And even Roger Moore plays it like that. I mean, I guess he's supposed to be. Is it supposed to be funny? Because I didn't laugh. I didn't find it funny. The fact that there's this young girl who's really too young for him is waiting in bed for him. I didn't really like that at all. I guess it kind of also highlights that Roger Moore is getting older and he's showing his age a bit more. And through this film, he does feel a little more tired, but he gets away with it. I think Roger Moore's performance in the film is fine, but I just think on a physical level, he is a bit slower than he used to be. I guess my other complaints about the film are Luigi. Luigi Ferrara dies. Yeah, that's it. He's in about two scenes and then he gets killed. You'll find this with every John Glenn Bond movie. He will kill off all the allies. He just does, I don't know why. He kills off Luigi in For Your Eyes Only, VJ in Octopussy, Tibbet in A View to a Kill, Saunders in The Living Daylights, and Sharky in License to Kill. I don't know why, but it's just, you know, it doesn't label him as an auteur or anything, but it's just a bit strange. The pace of this movie really drags at points. The first half is pretty good, and it moves along fine, but the second half comes along, and the movie really slows down, and it becomes almost boring by the second half, which is a real shame. Speaking of boring, we have a couple of underwater fighting scenes. I thought we would have learned from Thunderball that underwater fighting doesn't always work, and it's just boring. They spend too long underwater in this film. Not as much as Thunderball, but still. It's, you know, by the time you get past the first hour, you're starting to think, come on, Roger, let's speed things up a bit. Come on, John, let's move it along. Another thing to mention is that there is no M in this film. Obviously, the sad passing of Bernard Lee meant that they chose not to have M in this film, which I respect. They say in the film that M is on leave, which I appreciate. I think it would have been very rash to cast someone else that quickly. So they have a one film break from M, which is, you know, I totally respect that. So thank you for that. In the next film, Robert Brown will take his first film as M, and we'll see him for the next four movies. He won't be M for very long, but he'll be there for four movies. The title song by Sheena Easton, the For Your Eyes Only song, it's alright. Kind of my feeling for most of this film, it's just alright. I don't think that the For Your Eyes Only song is lyrically bad. It's actually lyrically pretty good, and lyrically it's better than Moonraker. It's just another sugary, schmaltzy ballad, and it's just, in a way, kind of whiny. Not because of Sheena Easton, but just kind of the way it's written. For your eyes only, you'll see what no one else can see. It just comes across to me as very soppy. That's kind of how I see it, really. The title sequence is weird, to say the least. Morris Binder, who did all the titles from Dr. No all the way to License to Kill, had a bit of a crush. Well, I'd say a bit of a crush. He had a bit of an infatuation, shall we say, with Sheena Easton. So he put her in the title sequence, which in terms of the artists has never been done before and never has been done since. I mean, I can't imagine Billie Eilish will actually be in the title sequence for No Time to Die. And the title sequence itself, there's not really much to it. It's just water and women. There's no theme. It's just kind of recycled. A lot of it is the same thing. And it's not very visually exciting. Roger Moore's in the title sequence as well, but the Moonraker one was better. And that's saying something. The cast of the movie, however, are very good. Roger Moore as James Bond, this is his fifth movie now. So, you know, he's starting to show his age a little bit. Not much, just a bit. I think in this film, Roger Moore gets away with it, and he does still turn on the charm when he needs to with the ladies, especially in the scene with with Liesel, the Countess Liesel, played by Cassandra Harris, who actually married Pierce Brosnan. Roger Moore definitely has his charming moments, and I like the fact that Bond does not bed Melina straight away. The fact that he's considerate to her because she's lost her parents and she's going on a revenge quest. The fact that he doesn't sleep with her straight away is nice and very, you know, respectful. You know, because Bond could have easily have just exploited that and just, you know, had sex with her. There's a scene in the carriage where he tells her to go away because he's on the trail and he's involved and he's trying to find Christatos. And she's not having it. But he says, no, I will deal with it and I will come and meet you afterwards. It's great to see Bond and Melina work together very well. Carole Bouquet as Melina Havelock. Oh my God. I have to say, she is one of the best Bond girls for me. Melina is brilliant. And I like her story, the fact that she's going out for revenge after the death of her parents, which is a very tragic sequence, even though we don't know the parents for very long. I still think that it was generally quite shocking when Gonzalez murders them, and there's that shot that zooms into her eyes when we see her get angry. I think that Melina is a very emotionally driven character, and I think she's probably the best written character in this movie, aside from Bond. She's just on a personal level. Also, I think that she is a beautiful lady. My God, I want to marry this woman. Carole Bouquet is gorgeous. She has lovely long brown hair. She's got a gorgeous body, and I think she's a great choice for a Bond girl. So whoever cast her, good job. For your eyes only, darling. Topol as Milos Columbo. I like Columbo. The fact that we don't really know which side he's on at the beginning is nice, but he turns out to be a very nice ally. I have to say, Julian Glover as Christatos is he's a terrible villain. I don't hate the performance, I just think that he is underwritten. He doesn't get very much to do, and the character I don't get his motivations. Like, why is he doing what he's doing? The film doesn't take the time to really explain it. Because he's not on screen enough, we don't get the full sense of his plan or what he intends to do, really. And why he's such an arsehole to BB as well. But I mean, to be fair, if anyone had to put up with her for so long, no wonder he slapped her. Of course, Cassandra Harris, rest in peace, as Liesel, who's only in the film for about 5 minutes, but her death scene is quite tragic as well, when she gets run over on the beach. That's very tragic, but she's a gorgeous lady, and it's very easy to see why Pierce Brosnan fell in love with her and married her, but her death is pretty tragic in this film. Michael Gothard as Locke as well, he's a pretty good villain. I like the way he dies. When Roger Moore goes over to the car and he says, you left this with Ferrara, I believe, which is the little dove pin, and he throws it into the car and then kicks it down the cliff. That's a very cold moment for Roger Moore. That's one of his best moments. A lot of people like that moment, and I could certainly see why. The MI6 regulars are very good in this film, although there's no M in the film. We have Geoffrey Keane taking a bigger part as the minister, and I think he does a good job standing in, shall we say. Lois Maxwell gets her token scene as well, and she's good. And Desmond Llewelyn gets a fair amount to do as well. There's a good scene when he's testing out the identograph, which is nice. So it's nice to see the Lotus come back, even briefly. We only see it in a couple of shots. The action sequences in this film are a very mixed bag. Like I said, the underwater fight is not great. For me, the third act drags. The moments when Bond is scaling the cliff, that takes forever and it takes a while. And by the time we finally get to the monastery, there's not much of a climax left. Christatos runs away with the ATAC device and he's taken out so easily. Columbo just throws a knife into his back. Bond and Christatos don't really get to have a fight. I would have preferred for him to have a villain's one-on-one fight. A lot of these films don't do that, which is a shame. And then Bond just destroys the ATAC device very quickly. The third act was very abrupt in the way it finished. And yeah, I thought Chris Stathos had a very anticlimactic death, which is a real shame. But that being said, the boat fight was really good. I liked the boat fight. That was very explosive. Ski chase slash bobsleigh chase is probably the best action scene in the film and my favourite. The car chase I like, and it's kind of funny seeing Bond and Melina drive around in one of those little yellow cars. Going back to basics, like I said. I think the production design is pretty good and the sets are good. But it's hardly the most impressive film of the series. For me, I've heard that this one gets a lot of acclaim, and some people actually rate it as their favourite of the Roger Moore era, which is fine, which is great. But for me, I don't think I'll ever understand why people think this film is so good. I just don't. For me, this is, without question, one of the weakest, if not the weakest film in Roger Moore's era. I don't know. It's just a very mixed bag tonally, and there are just things that I don't like about it, and I think are stupid, really. I know that my friends Alan Kalo and Sam Harrison like this film, and each to their own. I mean, great for you, but I'm not really a fan of this. I do really like Melina, though. Melina, as a character, is very well written and one of the best of the series. For me, she is one of the most beautiful Bond girls of the series as well. So to kind of wrap it up, For Your Eyes Only is a very mixed bag for me. I don't normally go back to this one very much. It's not got a very good villain. The story's a bit dull in comparison. The opening and the ending are just weird. To me, it wasn't as fun as Moonraker or some of the previous Moore films. It's not the worst in the series. I won't say it's the worst film of the series, but it's not one that I rush back to. To wrap it all up, I will be kind, and I will give For Your Eyes Only a marginal pass at 6 out of 10. Thank you very much for watching, and I will see you next time for my review of Octopussy, which is the 12th film in the series and Roger Moore's 6th adventure as 007. So, until next time, Bond fans, so long for now.